Right. Well, very nice to be with you and glad to be a fixture in this place. It's good and good to be back with you. I want you to imagine it's about 30 years ago and a Bible conference is on the go. Listen, Bible conference is not that common nowadays, but 30 years ago it was fairly usual that churches would have a time where, like over a week, they would unpack a passage of scripture, they get an inspiring teacher in, and that would take place over a period of time. And it was great, and was a wonderful time. And at this particular Bible conference, the preacher was very passionate and wanted to help people just to love the Bible. Wanted to help them to love the Bible so much more. Incidentally, welcome to you if you're on stream. I realized I didn't actually welcome you as well, but really nice that you're here. Now, you can't say thank you for that welcome back, but I'm sure that you appreciate it, and I appreciate you as well. Okay, so here's this preacher. He's at this Bible Inspiration Conference and getting all enthusiastic, and he says to the congregation, so how many of you here, love the Bible, love it from cover to cover? If so, just pick your Bibles up and wave them in the air. Now, this was a day where everyone brought their Bible with them. They wouldn't have, today we just have phones flying everywhere if people tried to do that. But back then, everyone raised their Bible, and many of them were like these black-covered King James version of the Bible, for the traditionalists, and the Good News Bibles for the rebels, but they were waving their Bibles back and forth. And he said, okay, so you love the Bible. And hey, if you believe the Bible, if you believe it from cover to cover, pick it up and wave it in the air. And there was this great wave of people waving their Bibles back and forth because this was not a cynical or skeptical crowd. And then he said, and if you've read the Bible, read it from cover to cover, lift your Bibles up and wave it in the air. And suddenly most hands just remained down. And so he said, here's the thing. You love the Bible. You believe the Bible. You just don't actually read the Bible. You love the Bible, you believe it, you just don't actually read it. Now, we could look at that and you could say, okay, that's appalling. You could kind of go straight into judgmental mode. On people such hypocrites, we say, we love the scriptures and how wonderful they are and everything else, but we don't actually spend that much time reading them. Aren't we hypocrites? But it's probably best not to go there. Probably much better to just be a little bit curious. So that's interesting. How could it be that a large group of people, and I suspect that this is true here as well. I mean, if I were to ask you how many of you read the Bible from cover to cover, I'm not going to, don't worry. But I suspect, and because your pastoral staff would be, well, I won't comment. many of you, I think, might feel just a tad awkward because actually so many people haven't. And yet we do love the Bible, and we do believe it, and we do believe it's actually important. So let's be curious. Why don't we actually get to read it all? And I think that there are a number of answers. Listen, we understand why the Bible is important. We do understand that it is important. I was principal of Bow Seminary for 17 years, and often in my classes, and certainly if you went into one of the wonderful theology classes of Michael O'Neill, who now heads up Bow Seminary or the Bow's campus of Morland College as it is now, would often quote Karl Barth, because Karl Barth kind of really puts it really well why we should read the Bible. And I'm just going to paraphrase what he said, because if you don't paraphrase Karl Barth, I'll be here forever. Like, he never said anything briefly. So he basically says this: ask 1,000 different people what God is like, and you will get 1,000 different answers. Does that mean there are 1,000 different gods? No, said Barth. It means that there are 1,000 different idols, 1,000 different gods of our own making. So said Barth, how can we know what God is actually like? How can it be beyond just your thoughts versus my thoughts versus just speculation? Barth said two words, and he said these two words are Deus dixit, Deus dixit. What does that mean? God has spoken. God has spoken. We can know what God is like because God has spoken. God has met with us. There have been multiple God encounters in the course of history. And in those God encounters, as God has met with us, as God has encountered humans, we have a record of them, and they've been recorded for us in the Bible. And as we read them, we realize, Deus dixit, God has spoken. And therefore, it is not actually my opinion versus yours. It is God's own revelation of God's own self. It is God coming to us and saying, this is what I like. This is what I'm like. Here I am. I'm meeting with you now. Yeah. So we know the Bible's important because without the Bible, we're just in the realm of guesswork. Your guess as good as mine, but none of us really knowing what we're talking about at all. The Bible transforms that for us. So why aren't we reading it more? So you may say, but you know, it's actually, when you get to the Bible, I mean, I love the idea of the Bible. I love this idea the day sticks of God has spoken. That's glorious. But you know, when you actually get to it, like those genealogies. Have you read some of those? I mean, do you get like really excited when you read the genealogies in the Bible? This person begat that person, begat that person, begat that person, begat that person. And just there's such a lot of begatting. Like on a permanent honeymoon, I guess. But and let's not get sidetracked there. So much begatting. But like, I mean, that doesn't feel very exciting. Or what about all the corpses in the Bible? I mean, have you noticed how many corpses there are? They're just everywhere. I don't know. I mean, this is a younger crowd, so maybe you don't watch Midsummer Murders, but us older people here, we do. And if you watch Midsummer Murders, you know that, like, when you watch something like that, you go to it, and you know that your task is to identify the murderer. You've got to catch him. But you also know that if you're a good Midsummer Murder person, you've got to anticipate who's going to be a corpse by the end of the program. And there are lots of them. And it's very, very dangerous to be in the cast of Midsummer Murder because you'll probably be murdered somewhere along the line. But let me tell you, it is much more dangerous to appear in the script of the Bible, because in the Bible script, people just drop like flies. Boom, 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 boom. There are corpses everywhere. I mean, and it's not just the Old Testament. Take Acts chapter 5. Have you ever thought much about Acts chapter 5? The account of Ananias and Sapphira. So here's this very generous couple. They have some property, and they decide they want to sell it. And they decide, we're going to give the proceeds of that to the church. Well, we're going to give most of the proceeds of it to the church. We'd like to just like keep ourselves a little bit secure, thank you very much. Which is fine, no problem whatsoever. Except that they make this plan that they want people to think, like they really want people to think that they're amazing, incredible people, that they're so generous. And so they tell the church just a little porky. And the little porky is this. This is what we sold the field for, and we've given it all to you. They wouldn't say that they wanted to hold just a little bit back of it. And so Ananias goes up and presents that to Peter, and Peter says, okay, so this is everything that you got. That's wonderful. Is that actually the truth? And Ananias says, yes. And Peter says, nope. Boom, bing, he's dead. He's a corpse. And Ananias, dead, just like that. And his wife comes in a little bit later. And Peter says to her, so this is what you sold your field of land for? This all the money that came from? Oh, yes, absolutely, she says, telling, you know, yet another little porky there. And he says, bing, you're dead. And she drops down. She's another corpse. And you say, my goodness, these people are so generous and they still land up dead. I mean, this is awkward. And you think, I'm not sure I want to find myself in this passage here. You know, how do I understand this? How do I understand this? So let's recognize it as a little bit of a dilemma when we come to the Bible. We know that it's really, really important, and yet it can be a hard book to read, and it can be a hard book to fathom. So is there a way to help us? Well, I'd like to suggest just a little method that's not difficult to follow, and I think it's worth thinking about. It's what I call the 4-H method. That when you read the Bible, read it with your head. Read it, but in other words, try to really understand it. When was it written? Why was it written? Who was it written to? What was the purpose behind it? What is the intention behind the passage? Don't worry so much about the instructions. Look at the purpose behind every passage that's actually been written, and it's not that hard to figure out if you just dive in a little bit into the history. So you read it with your head, read it with your heart, because the Bible itself says in Hebrews 4, that the Bible's like a double-edged sword. And it goes right to our hearts, and it helps to analyze what we're feeling and our emotions and our motivations for doing things. And it challenges us and often sets new directions for us. So read it with your heart. Read it with your hands. What do I mean to read with your hands? Well, it's Psalm 119, verse 105. Your word is a light unto my path, a lamp unto my feet. It gives us direction. We're supposed to live differently as a result of following the teaching of this book. So we do it there, but read it one more way. Read it with an openness to the holy. In other words, sometimes when you read the Bible, this remarkable thing happens. You're reading it and you're thinking about its background and it's kind of speaking to you and you're thinking about what you must do as a result of what it teaches. And then suddenly, boom, you realize that you are actually in the presence of God. I've said to students, as I said, I was principal there for many years. Pretty much every group of students that came in at one point or another, I said, you know, here you are at theological college and you're going to be reading the Bible. And you're going to think that you are in charge of the process. And as you study here, you will get better and better at interpreting the text. You will learn Greek. You will learn Hebrew. You'll be able to look and you'll be able to say, actually, the three Greek meanings of that word could be. And you know, the Hebrew over here is a little bit obscure, but it probably means this or that. You will be able to do all those things. And as you do, you'll feel, wow, I really have got this. And you will feel as though somehow you are over the text. But you will find that from time to time, that text just flies out from under you and kind of, as it were, it's on top of you. And the text that you're reading is the text that reads you. Wow. And that's the remarkable thing. As it reads back into your life and it speaks to you and you challenge you and you suddenly realize, oh my goodness, God is speaking to me. God is speaking to me. It's not just a Deus Dixit that God has spoken. Deus Dixit, God has spoken to me. And that's transforming. It's the Isaiah 6 experience. Do you remember the account? It's the year that King Uzziah dies. It is a traumatic year after his very lengthy reign. And as he dies, everyone wonders what the future for the nation will be. And Isaiah goes into the temple. And he goes to the temple. He struck these angelic beings, these cherubims. And they're there and they're singing to each other back and forth, holy, 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 holy is the Lord God Almighty. And Isaiah just stands there and thinks, what am I doing here? I don't deserve to be here. I can't stand in this place. And he says, you know, woe unto me. I'm undone, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live in the midst of a people of unclean lips, and I've seen the Lord, the King of glory. But God says to him this, whom shall I send? Who will go for me? Whom shall I send? Who will go for me? And Isaiah hears himself saying in a trembling voice, here am I, send me. Didn't think that was coming, didn't expect that. But sometimes we just have those kinds of encounters where we're not anticipating anything, but God dramatically comes through. And so when you read the Bible, read it with your head, read it with your heart, read it with a willingness to activate your hands. Read it with an openness to the holy. You say, that sounds a bit theoretical. You know, earth it. You know, what does that mean in practice? And I'd like to say, okay, well, let's try and see what it means by looking at a specific passage in the Bible. And let's look at one which, in its own way, is a fairly controversial passage. Psalm 137. Now, when I started off by the rivers of Babylon, you may think that you remember this because those of you, again, listen, it might again be those of you a little bit older, but do you remember this song? And do we have it there? Could we actually just play it? There you go. Feel free to just dance along and to jump up on your chairs and to celebrate and to sing this truly ridiculous song. Turn it off, please. It is truly appalling that song was hugely successful. Appalling because I've never ever known a song where a tune and the words are more discordant. They just scream against each other and no one noticed. I mean, the mass stupidity of humanity is great indeed. And you'll realize that actually when you read the psalm, because it is a deep lament. It is not a disco song where you look out for the talent, thank you very much. So Psalm 137 says this, and listen to it, and this is the one we want to unpack. By the rivers of Babylon, we sat and wept when we remembered Zion. There on the poplars we hung our harps, for there our captors asked us for songs. Our tormentors demanded songs of joy. They said, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How can we sing the songs of the Lord while in a foreign land? If I forget you, Jerusalem, May my right hand forget its skill. May my tongue cling to the roof of my mouth. If I do not remember you, if I do not consider Jerusalem my highest joy. Remember, Lord, what the Edomites did on the day Jerusalem fell. Tear it down, they cried. Tear it down to its foundations. Daughter Babylon, doomed to destruction. Happy are those who repay you according to what you have done to us. Happy are those who seize your infants and dash them against the rocks. Wow. Feel like dancing to Boney M at the end of that? I mean, seriously, this is a deep lament. This is a deep lament. And in its own way, it is a deeply problematic passage, isn't it? I mean, fancy a psalm that says, happy are those who will take your children and smash them on the rocks. I can remember listening to watching a Q&A program a couple of years back when people still used to watch Q&A, and I can't remember who the atheist was. I think it was A.C. Grayling, but I'm open to correction on that one. But they were talking about the Bible, and Grayling comes in and he just says, why anyone would consider the Bible a moral guide is beyond me. Don't you know, for example, that there is a Psalm 137, which says, you know, happy are those who take your children and smash them against the rocks. Are you going to guard your children? You know, the book that says things like that. I mean, why would anyone suggest that we build a moral code for Western democracy on a book that is quite as barbaric as that? Now, that was a statement. No one challenged him. No one challenged him. And perhaps as you're sitting here at the moment, you say, well, of course not, because actually this is quite an awkward psalm. It's a psalm that seems to encourage violence. Hold on. Why? I mean, always be curious. So why is the psalmist saying this? Well, let's look at the psalm. By the rivers of Babylon. It sounds so lovely, doesn't it? I mean, I don't know what you think about when you think about a river. I think about lovely, romantic setting. My wife, Rosemary, and I have been married for over 40 years now. And I proposed to her on the banks of the Kroonstad River back in South Africa. And so when I think of rivers, I think of picnic lunches and canoeing and proposing and Rosemary bursting into delighted tears and 40 years of wonderful marriage and lovely, lovely things. But hold on. These are the rivers of Babylon. Okay, they're lovely rivers. Do you know what those rivers are? The Euphrates and the Tigris rivers. They're great rivers. They're the reason that Babylon was so successful, agriculturally very prosperous, did really well as a nation. They're great rivers, very, very important to Babylon. Yeah, but who's writing this? By the rivers of Babylon, and this is a Hebrew author, so what is he doing there? This is not by the banks of the Jordan River. This is by the rivers of Babylon. Why are we there? Why are we weeping? Well, if you know something about the history of Israel, you know that there were two extraordinary traumatic events in her history. After she reached her golden era under King Saul, then David, then Solomon, the kingdom sadly split into two parts, split into what came to be known as the Northern Kingdom and split into the Southern Kingdom. The Northern Kingdom was just appalling almost from day one, rebelled against God over and over. And the year 722, the Assyrians swept down on them and destroyed them, completely destroyed them. That part of Israel never, ever recovered again. Never, ever. They were gone. And then in the year 586, the Babylonians came in. They had been coming in a number of ways. There had been some early raids where people like Daniel and others were taken off into captivity into Babylon. But in 586, the raid in proper began. And they destroyed the temple in Jerusalem. Jerusalem's pride and joy. But it wasn't just that they destroyed the temple. They were known for their barbarism. And so if you had watched at a distance what was happening there, you would have seen them systematically rape pretty much every woman who was there. If you were a man, your wife, if your life was spared, almost certainly you would have watched as your wife was abused and raped. You would have watched as they took your children and viewed them as too difficult to manage, a liability, and so just picked them up and smashed them to the ground, and you would have watched your children being killed. You would have watched your farm, which maybe had been in your family for generations and generations, just torched, set alight, absolutely destroyed. And then if you were assessed as being fit for the journey, a strong male who could be a useful slave, you would have been put into shackles and you would have begun your journey to Babylon and you would have begun that long trek. And this psalm picks up somewhere along that journey. And in that journey, we get to the rivers of Babylon and a break is called for a while. And sitting by these rivers in Babylon, our captors, they are having probably a lovely barbecue. They're having a lovely evening. They perhaps are drinking a little bit too much. They're perhaps having a little bit of a sing-along. And suddenly they turn to you. Imagine if you're the person there. I mean, they turn to you and they say, "Oh, you Hebrews, you're wonderful singers, aren't you? I'm sure you've got some national songs. I mean your nation's been destroyed, but never mind, your songs are still there. Sing us one of the songs of Zion. Don't you want to sing? Come on, we have a lovely sing-along. Join in. And you just feel a fury beyond the describing of it welling up inside of you. By the rivers of Babylon, we sat and we wept, for there our tormentors demanded of us songs. But we hung up our harps and we said, we will never sing again. It's a psalm of lament. It's a psalm of deep sorrow. It's a psalm from a very, very dark place. It's a psalm in a very difficult day. And if you cannot understand that, you cannot understand the psalm at all. And when people like A.C. Graylin, brilliant that he might be, make comments like, "Oh, fancy a psalm saying that we should smash babies on the rocks," with all due respect, he shows himself to be abysmally ignorant of the context. Abysmally ignorant. Because this is a psalm. It's a psalm of human pain, and it is of raw human emotion that is expressed in the face of God. And to express our emotion and our sadness in the face of God is the safest place of all to express it. It is the safest place of all to express it. So, when we read the psalm, we need to say, first of all, this is what our head tells us. This is the background. This is the context of this particular psalm. The first three verses, they give this lament of our being told that we must sing the songs of Zion to our captors. Verses 4-6, we commit ourselves back to Jerusalem again. We remember that that was the place that we truly were happy. And we say that we will never forget where we have come from. And verse 7-9, we pray that somehow God will bring vengeance for this terrible evil that has fallen upon us. That's how the psalm is structured. That's what our head tells us. When you read it with your heart, I don't know. What does the psalm say to you? It could mean so many different things, couldn't it? Some of you maybe have come from another country. Maybe you haven't, but maybe you know what it is to long for home. Because I think in another way, this is a psalm about searching for home and wanting to feel at home all over again. It is about sitting by the rivers of Babylon and feeling completely out of place. It is about hearing everyone else singing and their songs and their cheerfulness and just feeling, I just don't belong here. I just don't fit in here. This is just not my place. These are just not my people. Have you ever felt like that? Maybe if you have, when you read this psalm, you might feel a little less alone, because it tells us and it reminds us that all through history, there have been people who have felt as though they're the outsiders, that they don't really belong and that they aren't in their home place. It might not even be reasonable. It might be, it could be that some of you feel just a little bit, you know, by the Swan River, I sat and I wept when I remembered Mumbai. By the Swan River, I sat and I wept when I remembered Jakarta. By the Swan River, I sat and I wept when I remembered Durban, where I grew up. Beautiful, beautiful city. Troubled times, but beautiful city. It's just about I'm not actually at home at the moment. And sometimes you feel that haunting sense in your heart. And the psalm says that and says there are times like that. And you know what? It's okay. And it's okay to give that to God. And it's okay to give that loneliness and not feeling that you quite belong, to hand that back to God. It's a reminder, of course, of another thing. It's a reminder that actually if you are at home, Celebrate that. In fact, the psalm reminds us of that as well, because it says, you know, I'm not going to remember Jerusalem as my highest joy. But if you are in Jerusalem, for goodness sake, the psalm is saying to you, remember that, enjoy it. You know, if this is a good season in your life, seize that, appreciate that. So on the one hand, it's a psalm of deep empathy. Some of deep empathy for those who have lost everything, but it's also a reminder that life has different seasons. And if you're in the season where you are at home, be at home, be grateful. For goodness sake, don't whinge over trivia. When you're at home, when you belong, and these are your people, and you whinge, please learn from the psalm. The psalm says, you're at home, celebrate, be grateful. These are your rivers, these are your people. And reach out to those who don't find it like that and listen to their stories and help them to find a home. I mean, there are so many. It might not be about geography. It might be in my relationship. You know, I sit here and I weep because the time that once was is not the time that is now. And I remember a relationship that was once wonderful and I took it for granted. And I'm sitting here today and I'm wondering what has happened and what has gone wrong. I weep by the rivers of Babylon and I weep in the presence of God. With your heart, read the psalm and see if perhaps God is saying something to you. It is not just to be read with your heart, it's to be read with your hands. And you say, how do we read the psalm with our hands? Well, don't make the mistake of grailing and kind of say, presumably it's a completely literal psalm and you must do exactly what it says. That's just so unimaginative and so appallingly dumb. You need to read it with imagination, for goodness sake. So are we saying, when you say do something with your hands, then pick up babies and smash them on the rocks because it says that? No. It is saying, what do you do with your anger and your rage? What do you do with your bitterness? What do you do with your deepest resentments? It says you scream them out to God. Did you notice these verses? Verse 7. Remember what the Edomites did. No, you missed out a word there. Remember, Lord, what the Edomites did. Now, that word Lord changes everything. Because it says to us, in what context is the screaming taking place? It is taking place in the very presence of God. And I don't know if you have a concept of God that says God is someone you always have to be polite to. God is the one that you tell little lies to. God is the one you pretend with. I mean, for goodness sake, why on earth would you do that? God knows everything. And so the passage says, be completely honest with God. Bring your rawest concerns to God because he already knows. And they're safe in the hands of God. And there is a cathartic element in this psalm. It's basically saying, I scream this out for God because I have to be able to carry on at the end of it. And if I don't get rid of this rage, I won't be able to manage. let me give you an example that maybe is a little bit silly, but bear with me. So, years back, I used to play squash. I accept that you might not find that credible. I'm not going to pretend that I was a wonderful, marvelous kind of Olympian squash player, because I seriously wasn't, but I used to enjoy it at a very ordinary kind of a level. And I used to play with a number of other pretty ordinary players. And we had lots of fun, because when you're both ordinary, it's glorious. And one of the people that I used to play with, Carl was his name, we used to play fairly regularly. One day we there, kind of booked the courts for 5:30, and he arrives just a few minutes late, and like, it's just obvious, the moment he arrives there, he is furious. No, he's actually usually a very genial, very happy-go-lucky, very warm kind of a guy, but he is so furious today. And he says to me, I just don't know what I'm gonna do. I've never been so angry in my life. And he told me that he had been working on a project at his work for over a year. And I knew how hard he had been working. He'd been pouring in, like in the end, it was hundreds of hours of unpaid overtime because he believed in this project and he really wanted it to do well. And the presentation had taken place that day and his boss had done the presentation, nothing wrong with that, except that his boss at the end, people were like, wrapped with the project, and his boss had taken every bit of credit, like every bit of credit, even though his boss had done almost nothing. But what is more, his boss had made all these disparaging comments about him all the way through, implying that somehow he had been this idiot who almost botched the whole project, and that, you know, if it hadn't been for the boss, this would have all gone amiss, and that, you know, he put up with incompetence along the way, but, you know, now they had this good project. And Carl, my friend, just said he was so furious. And he said, and I just want to leave, but I can't, because I can't afford to leave at this point in time. And so I've just got to be there tomorrow, and I've got to smile at him and say hello. And his boss's name was Mr. Swanson. You know, hello, Swanny, kind of whichever one called him, and pretend that everything was okay. And I said to him, so Carl, you know, we're going to play squash. How about you just imagine that the squash ball is Swanny's rear behind, kind of. So how are you going to play today? And like I did that just as a light kind of a comment, but oh my goodness, he took me up. I have never, ever, ever seen a squash ball hit so hard. Not once. But like, it's the first time I've been genuinely scared on a squash court. Like, oh, the ball was just flying everywhere. And it's like, you are just scary. And I think I got no points in that game. It was over in no time whatsoever. And in an incredibly short space of time, he completely annihilated me. And he just said, oh, I feel so much better. And I said, I'm really glad you do. I don't. But it was about getting something out. You know, when you get something out of you, then you can breathe again and you can move again. And you can do the things that life requires of you. This is an extraordinary permission-giving psalm. It says, take your anger, take your rage, take your deepest hurts, but place them at the feet of the God who hears, the God who understands, the God who knows, the God who ultimately can set everything to right. And leave them there with that God. I said we need to read with our heads, with our hearts, with our hands, and we might need to write and to speak things out and to scream things out. But I said also, just watch for the holy that sometimes comes, and sometimes comes in moments when we don't really expect it. Because sometimes as you read a psalm like this or some other passage, you find yourself just encountering God. And God comes and meets with you. Perhaps it would be a little bit like the encounter of Elijah. Do you remember 1 Kings 19? Elijah has had this dramatic power encounter with the prophets of Baal in 1 Kings 18. It has been a dramatic encounter, and for reasons that are difficult to understand, straight after that, as Queen Jezebel threatens the prophet Elijah, he panics and he lands up in a depression and he's afraid and he runs to Mount Sinai and he climbs Mount Sinai. And while he's standing on Mount Sinai, and 1 Kings 19 tells us that there is suddenly an earthquake and then there's a great fire and there's a wind. And surprisingly, the passage says, but God was not in the wind. God was not in the fire. God was not in the earthquake. And you look and you say to the passage, I beg your pardon, that's nonsense. I mean, are we supposed to believe that it was just a pure coincidence that this wind, great wind comes up, that this fire comes up, that this earthquake, I mean, God must have been in them. And then you realize that God is actually saying, Elijah, don't be so impressed with those very big things. Don't be so impressed with those very big things. And after all those big, big things, there is just the quietest of things that happen. And we are told that there is a voice of gentle silence. And in that gentle silence, Elijah hears God coming to him and saying to him, Elijah, what are you doing here?